me to walk in the light of His love. Teach me to pray to my Father above. Teach me to know all the things that are right. Teach me to walk in the
Hello everyone, and welcome back to another Walk in the Light event. My name is Sister Abbott.
And my name is Sister Whitmer, and we'll be tonight's host.
As we get the event started and people are joining in, make sure to let us know down in the comments below where you are tuning in from.
Tonight we'll be going on an adventure as we joined by Traci Hunter Abramson. She is known for her charismatic style for writing and award-winning novels.
However, before we continue, we would love to open up tonight's event with the opening musical number by Natalie and Mike Kelsey. Following them, the opening prayer will be offered by Mavis Deshine, all of whom are members of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints living in the North Shore, Massachusetts area.
Thank you. Our dear Father in heaven, we are so thankful for this beautiful day, for the opportunity we have to attend this meeting. We are thankful for thy Son, Jesus Christ, and for all that he's done for us. We ask the Heavenly Father that thou will help us to do those things that would help us to be of service to those around us, that we will seek out the opportunities and act upon them. We thank thee for our friends and family members. We thank thee for all that thou hast given to us. We say these things in the name of thy Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
That was beautiful. Thank you so much for bringing the spirit into our event. As we said before, tonight we are joined by Traci Abramson.
At a young age, Traci Abramson decided she would become an author. But before fulfilling that dream, however, she pursued a career in financial and international business. This led her to a day job working for the Central Intelligence Agency, with writing as her hobby.
Though she loved her career in intelligence, she loved her family more. After 6 years with the agency, Traci resigned to raise her family. She credits the CIA with giving her the wealth of ideas as well as the skills needed to survive her children's teenage years. Since that time, Traci has gone on to write more than 25 best-selling novels and is a 5-time Whitney Award winner.
Traci, the time is now yours.
Thank you for that introduction. So I am very humbled to be here. I was going through the last few weeks and looking through some of the previous broadcasts, and wow, what an amazing group of people they have had in the past. So I'm truly humbled to be counted among the people who have been invited to participate in this program. So I am coming to you today from Stafford, Virginia, which is about 35 miles south of Washington, D.C. For those of you who know where Quantico Marine Base is, that's my backyard. So if you hear any rumblings during this broadcast, they're having target practice at the Marine Base. So shouldn't happen at night, but on occasion it does. So like they said, I moved to the D.C. area after graduating college when I was recruited by the CIA. It was literally right out of college. So that's kind of where I come from. And I have been writing books for, my first book came out in 2004. So been doing that for quite a while. But we're going to start out tonight by, I have a confession to make, and please forgive me for this. So for years, I have been looking forward, or I was looking forward to the year 2020. The year 2020 was the year my husband had picked for his retirement. I was going to have a daughter graduate from college. A son was graduating from high school. So this was like a big year. We were going to have a wedding. We had, you know, the Olympics were supposed to happen. We also had a family trip to Europe. I mean, it was going to be a great year. So we all know that last year didn't turn out quite the way I planned, and certainly not the rest of us either. But all of us have like similar lists of things that we were going to do, plans that we had made, and things that just, you know, disrupted in our lives. But some of the things we miss the most are the simple things. It's that, you know, hugging a friend, seeing somebody smile without a mask on, going to the grocery store and not feeling like you have to sanitize the grocery cart. So even going to school in person, my son is just hoping that will happen soon, but last week was supposed to be his first day and we had a snowstorm. So he got snowed out on his very first day of school, or in-person school. So, but throughout all of these losses and challenges we've had, you know, we've also had a lot of gains. We have had, you know, the technology. I'll tell you right now, I rely heavily on my children to do a lot of the technology type issues for me. And I've actually had to learn. So I'm developing new skills, even though I didn't necessarily want to. But also the fact that we're able to connect with people all throughout the world. You know, the fact that I hope we can see in the comments where everyone's from, but just we have people from everywhere. And it's just so amazing that opportunity is now afforded to us in ways that we maybe wouldn't have explored previously. But more than anything, I think that the way the world is now, it's taught us how to rely on the Lord to carry us through both the good times and our struggles. There was a quote by Elder Garrett W. Gong, and he said, "As we come to trust God, sometimes through pleading in our darkest, loneliest, most uncertain moments, we learn he knows us better and loves us more than we know or love ourselves." And I will tell you, I am always fascinated by how well the Lord knows us. Growing up, I believed I could be anything. My parents just, they indulged me and they thought, you know, like, okay, sure, you want to be a horse jockey? You're going to be way too tall and way too big for that. But okay, sure, we'll let you think that when you're, you know, 10. And I was also going to be a veterinarian until I realized I didn't particularly care for the sight of blood. But I never picked the astronaut thing. That was, you know, going into space wasn't my thing. But I had a lot of those ambitions. But one of the things that always sparks a memory is when I was in about third grade, I got this little invitation. Somebody gave me this birthday party invitation, and it had top secret on the front, and it was in this little manila envelope, just similar to the one that is on your screen. And my little third grade imagination took off. I was suddenly this little CIA operative, and I would carry that little invitation around. I carried it for weeks. I was going to be a CIA operative. I was going to be somebody that everyone could trust with their secrets. And like, I would go into and look around and like, okay, nobody's looking. I can peek at it. And oh my gosh, you guys would have laughed at me. It was quite comical. I look back now and I was like, yes, my parents probably had many, many comical moments of laughing at their child who was going to work for the CIA. And granted, I lived in Arizona. People in Arizona don't really work for the CIA. Like CIA around here in Virginia, it's not uncommon to run across somebody who works in the intelligence community or what we call the alphabet soup, FBI, DIA, CIA, you know, military, all of those types of things. But Arizona, it just really wasn't heard of. So fast forward a few years and I end up getting recruited. And I moved to this little, I grew up mostly in Phoenix, but I moved into this little tiny town called Cornville. And when my parents first moved there, I thought that they were joking because I at the time I was living in Caracas, Venezuela as an exchange student. And I was convinced that it was a practical joke. Because of course, 2 miles down the road is a town called Page Springs. And I'm sorry, I love my friends in Cornville, but Page Springs sounds much lovelier than Cornville. So this was something that happened. All of the people who are doing my security clearance show up and everyone in town is terrified that I am in trouble. I mean, here I'm this really good kid and they're all calling my dad saying, what in the world is going on? What did you do? And he's like, it's for an interview. She's fine. She didn't do anything wrong. It's really okay. But nobody in the world would have thought in this little tiny town that Traci Abramson was going to work for the CIA. And you can imagine how surreal it was the first day I drove through those front gates to drive in as a brand new employee. So this is a picture of the CIA headquarters where I worked for the last couple of years while I was with the agency. But like I said, very surreal walking in, having a badge, being able to go in. And it was also very difficult when I left, handing that badge in the last time. It was a struggle because it was such a family environment. But another seemingly impossible childhood dream I had was to be an author. It was probably my first choice. I mean, being a spy was a close second, but I really, being an author was just a dream. I was reading books and by authors that they were so talented, it made it look like it was easy to write a book. And so as I grew up and got older, I realized nobody actually does this for a living. Like, you can't make a living as an author. So I moved on and I basically just pursued other areas. I just didn't think that it would be a possibility. So I still had these stories that were just going on in my head. And I couldn't get them to stop. So rather than going insane, I finally started writing them down. And I became a closet writer. I bought my first computer. Yes, that is exactly what I looked like. I bought my first computer when I left the CIA. So I started finally being able to type instead of write in little notebooks. But nobody knew I was a writer. I loved making stories. I loved creating. And It was so bad that I would actually, every time I'd start a project, I would hit return multiple times so that I'd have a blank page at the end of the document. And if I heard anyone coming, I would really quick hit control end so that it would go to the end of the document and nobody would think that I was actually doing anything. So I kept just playing with this, and I didn't know anything about writing. I'd never had a class or anything. So I was filled with all sorts of doubts. I just had, you know, I love this sign. It says, welcome to doubt, don't stay long. And it's so true. Don't stay there long. I did stay there for a while, unfortunately. But I had all these doubts about my writing ability. And ultimately, I ended up confiding and sharing my work with my sister-in-law, Rebecca. And Rebecca is this amazingly talented individual who not only is a talented editor, but she's also a gifted teacher. And she took the time to read manuscript after manuscript, I mean, one version after another, and just patiently taught me how to write. And she was just so generous in sharing her gifts in that way. But finally, after about, it probably took me about 6 years, I finally sent in a manuscript and I said, okay, I'm going to try. I finally felt like I had something worth sharing because it really took me that long to feel like I had the ability to do that. I hand it to my husband, or I right after I mailed it, I went to my husband and I said, hey, guess what? I finally did it. I sent in my manuscript. And his response was, what manuscript? Because like I said, I was a closet writer. Nobody knew that I actually wrote this book. And now keep in mind, I was CIA. So I was trained to keep a secret and I was pretty good at it. So I did keep pretty good secrets from everybody, including my husband, if I needed to. Normally I don't, but that was, you know, it was kind of private at the time. But through this process of writing and submitting and rewriting and ultimately getting published, I learned a fundamental truth. And that is, the Lord blesses us with talents to bring us joy, to bring joy to others, and to help bring light into the world. Robert E. Wells said, the Lord has given us talents, gifts, and blessings. He expects us to magnify them, to use them in the service of others if he is to trust us. So we often think of talents as being things that everyone can see. It's the, you know, the athlete who is catching the winning touchdown. It's the, you know, the person who has a beautiful singing voice, the artist who can create something beautiful, you know, taking a blank canvas into something spectacular. And so we think about all of those things, but what we don't always think about are those talents that are maybe sometimes overlooked, but equally and sometimes more precious. You think about that person who is such a good listener, who always, you can just always go to them and know that they're going to be that shoulder you can cry on, that person who's going to make you laugh when you need it. And that loyal friend who is just that person who can make things better simply with a smile. I mean, you can, even with the mask on, you can see it in their eyes. You know that they're smiling at you. But our talents go far beyond winning a championship or having the name on the cover of a book or even winning a gold medal. Our talents, the ones that really matter, help uplift those around us. And they help us follow the path that will draw us closer to our Lord and Savior. There is a saying that I often share with teenagers I work with. I've worked with teenagers both at church and also I'm a high school swimming coach, coach the high school swim team. But one thing that I've seen, this is so true, it is attitudes are contagious. And my question for them is always, is yours worth catching? We have all had times when life has threatened to overwhelm us. We have people we trust that we can vent to, people who are willing to listen and share their love and help lift us up. You know, people who will just let us get those problems of every day out so that we can unload them, you know, to somebody. But we also have people who will fuel that fire, that they'll fuel up the negativity and they'll magnify those negative feelings rather than simply letting us work through them. So all of us are capable of being on either side of that equation. We can be the force to bring people up, or we can inadvertently bring people down. It can be hard, especially in situations like what we're dealing with right now. It's hard to stay positive, but it's a challenge worth taking. So when you think about just, you know, somebody giving you a fun text or making making a phone call, just connecting in any way. And it can be hard, especially with everyone wearing masks and stuff, but just making eye contact can be huge for people. But the other thing is things like, you know, what we're doing now is reaching out, connecting through social media in any way. But A positive post on Instagram or Facebook can bring a smile to so many. So here's one that I shared recently. My daughter, this is my grandson. He's just over a year old. And my daughter told him that he needed to put his jacket on so he could go for a walk outside. So clearly he was a little more literal than she intended. And anyone who knows me well knows that I'm not a real big person to wear shoes. And so clearly he takes after me on that. When it was snowing outside, he didn't really think that shoes were necessary either. So the grandma in me says, you have to put shoes on. But the me in me is like, eh, good job, kid. But it was just a silly slice of life. It didn't mean anything. You know, it was just, it's something that makes me giggle every time I look at it. And so it was just something easy to share with others. So as a novelist, I often begin each project with a simple question, and that is, what if? What if I could fly? What if I inherited $1 million? What if I could live anywhere I wanted? What if I could get the dream job I've always wanted? I'm happily married, but for my characters, it's like, what if somebody they've admired for years is suddenly notices them? What if I was an Olympic swimmer? And by the way, if you did not see Rowdy Gaines on Walk in the Light last week, definitely need to go back and check that out. It was really awesome. I am old enough to remember when he swam in the Olympics, and it was pretty amazing. But this question, what if, it can also be applied to real life. You know, when I look back at the crossroads of my late teenage years, I remember talking to my uncle, and I was contemplating what I should study in college. And at that point, computers were the next big thing. And everyone was, you know, pushing computer programming and a lot of different things. But there was just so many opportunities, and I didn't really know what I wanted to explore. But my uncle ultimately steered me toward finance as being a career that could open a lot of doors. Ultimately, I ended up taking his advice. And then during my senior year in college, I ran into my husband's bishop, who happened to be the recruiter at BYU that year, and for the CIA. And he asked me, when he ran into me, he's like, why aren't you on my list? You know, my interview list. And I said, well, you know, there's a few classes that it says it's required, and I don't have the correct classes for what you're looking for. And he's like, well, I bet you're close. Go ahead. I've got an opening. And he gave me a time and said, I want to see you. So I ended up going into this interview, and this was like, literally I just ran into him on campus, at the administration building. So I go back, I have an interview with him, which of course is a very simple interview because it's a man I know, and I've gotten to know him pretty well, and he's a very nice man. So it ended up that I was one of two people that the CIA took from BYU that year, even though on paper I wasn't the right fit. But once everything fell into place, I ended up getting the job that was a dream job for me. I never anticipated how much that decision, how significant it would be to take my uncle's advice, which gave me the career that, one of the careers I ended up doing, international business as well. But little decisions kept rippling through to put me in the path that I needed to be on. Had I not taken my uncle's advice, I may not have stumbled into several of the other degrees I ended up getting. I ended up getting a minor in international relations, but that was because I was interested in international business. And so everything just kind of wove together to literally, when I interviewed my second interview with the CIA, they said, it's like you custom made your degree to come work for us. And I didn't even mean to, even though that was a dream for me. It never occurred to me that that would be the case. This experience helped me understand that the Lord really does have a plan for us. And if we'll be open to those promptings and that inspiration, we really can be guided into the place to be the person that He intends us to be. My experiences with the CIA ended up becoming a strong foundation for the books that I now write. Ultimately, it allowed me to work from home while raising my children and building an entirely different career, one that does not require me to commute on the Washington, D.C. Beltway, which is a huge bonus. I'm just going to tell you that. So we don't often think about how much just each decision we make can ripple through our lives, but not only our lives, but also through the lives of others. Every success I've had, every book I've published is due in large part to the people who have helped me in the early stages of my writing career, as well as the inspiration that the Lord has been kind enough to share. There aren't many feelings that match reading something you wrote and knowing that the words are more than what you're capable of creating for yourself. I remember it was my fifth book, but it was the fourth one to come out because the two flipped in the cycle. But I remember sitting down at the computer every day. I remember putting my fingers on the keyboard every day. And I remember putting certain hours in every day. At that point, it was during my son's nap time. And 5 weeks later, there was a manuscript on my desk. And I'm still not quite sure how that happened, but I just look back amazed that that process can be so magical at times. But I have to tell you, the best part of being an author by far is the people I get to meet and the friendships, the friends that have come from connecting with both my readers and other authors. So here's just a small selection of friends. Some of them are readers, some of them are, the one in the top in the middle is actually my editor who has been with me. She's been working with me for a lot of years. Backlash was the first one, so that's more than half of my books now. But just the joy that comes from working with these people and just their genuine kindness, and it's just been amazing. Because, you know, in theory, you would think that authors are like, well, you know, if somebody buys their book, then maybe they won't buy mine. And so technically, I guess we should be in competition with each other, but it's never felt like that. Maybe I'm just lucky that I have this amazing circle of, you know, writing circle, but I have the ones I deal with, or the ones I work with and have associated with, they have been nothing but supportive. They're constantly cheering for each other's successes. They share their knowledge to help others improve. And they also can be fiercely protective of one another. You know, if something happens, they just really want to, you know, hey, what can we do to help you? But quite simply, they are just amazing people. But in a blessing I received years ago, I was promised that the Lord would always provide friends for me in my different situation in life. And this has been such an example for me through this career. But I can't even begin to name all the people who've helped. You know, it was a similar situation when I was with the CIA. Because while I'm working there, you can't talk about what you do at home. So you end up with this different family. So just knowing that I've gone through these wonderful friends over the years and that people have been supported at the time that I needed it has just been amazing. But I can't begin to name all of the people who have helped me through different trials, but there are a couple of experiences I wanted to share. My sister-in-law, Rebecca, who I mentioned earlier, she had a really difficult life. First, she was divorced with two young children. And then after she remarried and this amazing man, she was widowed after only 6 months after her son was born, her youngest child. A few years later, she began what would ultimately be a 10-year battle with breast cancer. But when Rebecca was going through that first surgery for cancer, my husband and I just started finishing off our basement. And we both had this strong impression that we needed to finish quickly. Like, we needed to be done. We needed, it couldn't be a long lingering project. And we, in the back of our minds, we're like, oh my gosh, is she going to make it? Is she going to stay with us long enough? Or are we going to end up raising her children? Cause she had three children. And it really did concern me. Like, in my mind, I'm like, oh my gosh, not only can I not imagine not having this friend with me, but also how to help these children, if they were to lose their mom. And as it turned out, her two oldest children were well into adulthood by the time Rebecca did ultimately pass away. But my husband and I were honored to step in and help raise her youngest son, Gabriel. I should probably call him Elder Cummings now, since he is currently going through the virtual training to become a missionary for the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. So he's in the next room talking to missionaries right now. But I look back at Gabriel's childhood, and I am stunned at how kind the Lord has been in preparing our whole family for this situation. Rebecca moved into a house when she was pregnant with Gabriel, like it's maybe a mile away from me. So when Gabriel went to the same schools as my children. He didn't know that there was a doorbell on my door because he just always walked in. Like, he was just part of our family for his whole life. But the people who lived in this area, they came to know Rebecca as well as me. And so they knew after she passed away, they understood how precious that relationship was. But, and through those friendships, they've helped keep her memory alive, for both us and her children. But I look back, and when she did finally pass away, it was just the craziest time in my life. I was in charge of, like I said, I coach high school swimming. I was in charge of the regional swim meet, which happened literally like days before she passed away. And so right the day, 2 days before the funeral was our state meet. So I was juggling that. I was chairing a writer's conference in a different state that was going to happen a few months. My daughter got engaged right after Rebecca, like days after Rebecca passed away, and they decided that they wanted to get married like 3 months later. And I had a book to write. I was also, for those of you who are familiar with our faith, I was also the Relief Society president at the time. And that, so that's basically the president of the Women's Relief Organization. So needless to say, life was beyond overwhelming. I also was the executor of my sister-in-law's estate. We had to sell her house. We had to help her adult children move into new homes. We had to file for legal custody for Gabe. And so just the list went on and on. And I can tell you, the Lord is so kind. He gave us so much help in so many ways. There is no way we should have been able to accomplish everything we did during that time, but he kept providing all these angels here on earth that just carried our family through a very difficult time. I mean, my daughter's wedding was beautiful thanks to some dear friends who came in and just made it wonderful. And just every step of the way, there was just always somebody there. But we don't have to be going through these huge life-changing events to need the Lord's hand in our lives. Sometimes we simply have to recognize it. I mean, think about the fact that we have a vaccine, and yes, it's frustrating to decide whether or not to get it or not, and the rollout of how fast is it coming out, but the fact that we have one so quickly after this disease has been recognized, it's just truly a miracle in itself. Also, just the fact that the medical community has learned so quickly how to quickly to treat it. Everything that happens to us today is something we can build on tomorrow. And our yesterdays provide us a wealth of knowledge and experience that can help us now. Another experience I'd like to share started about 2 years ago, and I warned this friend that I was probably going to embarrass her today. But I received a text message from another author. Her name's Sean Bessie. And she... the two of us were with the same publishing house. Yes, that's Sean. This is actually at the BYU exhibit that's going on right now where we both wrote short stories. But she was kind enough to go and get a picture of our things because I haven't seen mine yet. But we had this big deadline coming up. And I was like pretty much getting pretty close to being done. And poor Sean had just had a lot of things happen. And she was not as close as she was should have been. And for whatever reason, and I truly think this was an inspired moment, she texted me. She was in Hawaii at the time while her husband was on sabbatical and texted me and was just like, why do I do this again? Or something along those lines, and was just struggling with trying to figure out her plot for her book and didn't have time to be stalled. You know, a lot of times authors will have that happen where you just, I just need to think about it for a while. And she just didn't have the time because of the pressing deadline coming in on her. So I was like, hey, if you want, call me, I'll call you or whatever. And I'm happy to talk out plot lines. And so I'll tell you, I ended up calling her and we brainstormed, and I probably benefited more because she's just a darling person and I just adore her. But and she's an example of one of many of the friends I could say the same thing about. But over that, knowing that she had this deadline coming up, and you know, I also was struggling with it a little bit, but I started texting her almost every day, and so it quickly turned into a two-way conversation of like, how are things going? And it wasn't long before I was deemed Coach Tracy because the coach would come out if she was, you know, like, okay, you know that you have to get this many words today to stay on track. So just don't forget. But then also being understanding of, hey, you know what, you have family coming into town. Why don't you take a day or two off? You could, if you do this, then you could still have the days you need and things like that. But we had been friends for a few years And even though I'd always delighted in seeing her at different author events and things like that, you know, we live on opposite sides of the country, so we hadn't gotten as nearly as close as we are now. But in the over this time, I mean, this was, like I said, about 2 years ago, I had no idea that this inspired friendship would become something I really needed. It was one that we built off of, and has just really been a lifeline during this time of, you know, of us having so much isolation. Both of us have wonderful friends where we live, but with being isolated, it gave us that extra boost that a lot of us have needed, you know, during this difficult time. The Lord knew that we both needed this backup plan. Despite having these wonderful friends, there were good times and bad times that we just really needed someone else to share it with. And never did I think during that initial phone call and text message that that would have created a friendship that I would need so much. So I look back on that friendship and with many friends that we have been supportive of me. And I'm so grateful for those, that kindness of others. Every bit of positive energy we put out into the world can ripple into something bigger, something greater than ourselves. We have the power to change the world and make it better for everyone around us, even in some cases for people we don't even know. On the night Rebecca passed away, this huge snowstorm hit our area, and my nephew, I promised him, he was already living with us, and I promised that we would actually go and that would wake him up no matter what. And on our way, so we're bundled up, it's the middle of the night, huge snowstorm, and we're driving to his house, you know, his old house, and we pass this car that is stranded in the snow. And I looked over and I said, look, right now it's all about you, but should we stop and help? And he basically said, yes. He's like, it's what Mom would want me to do. And his mother, even through 10 years of going through chemo and radiation, all these treatments, she had taught him the value of that service and that kindness to give to others. And now the funny moment was when we get back into the car after helping this car get out of the, you know, out of the snow and everything, Gabe said, it's 2 o'clock in the morning. Why didn't that policeman ask me why I was out past curfew? Because the man we'd helped was a policeman. So what can I say? We even have a sense of humor in difficult times in our family, but we're all going to struggle. But as Dallin H. Oakes said, the gospel of Jesus Christ is the plan by which we can become what children of God are supposed to become. This spotless and perfect state will result from a steady succession of covenants, ordinances, and actions, an accumulation of right choices, and from continuing repentance. This life is a time for men to prepare to meet God. I just want to end with this quote by Carol M. Stevens. It says, we can all get down on ourselves, but this saying is so true, that God never loses sight of our potential or of our eternal potential, even when we do. And I say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Traci, for that. That was perfect. Thank you. That question was real quick was that throughout everything that you shared, you had a positive experience, positive outlook, and all the stories, every story had a positive outlook. And to the very end, you said that God will help us become who we're meant to be. And the very end, God will try us as we let God help us along the way that we'll become who he needs us to be, who we need to become in the long end. So thank you. Thank you, Traci.
Yes, your message was exactly what I needed to hear. So I really appreciate that. And I'm sure everyone watching this was touched as well. But we'll go ahead and jump into our Q&A portion now and get a few questions in. But our first question says, how can we stay away from negative thinking that drags us down, sorry.
I mean, I think a lot of it just really comes down to remembering who we are. I mean, we are our Heavenly Father's children, and he doesn't make mistakes. He made us. Like, he's perfect. We're not perfect, but he is. But I think also just, you know, confiding in friends and, like I said, if you're using social media, use it in the positive light, you know, use it in a way that can help you find the positives. So
that's perfect. 100%. And we pull up our next question from Dexon Cox. Traci, your life is literally crazy. How do you calm the storms in your life?
a lot of exercise. I mean, okay, I'm actually on my exercise bike right now. Like, I write while I'm on the exercise bike in my treadmill. I think, you know, again, reading, I mean, I read my scriptures, I read something uplifting, listening to wonderful music, you know, anything that's uplifting that makes you happy is finding what works for you that makes brings joy to your life. You know, beautiful piece of artwork can do the same thing. So
yeah, again, that's contagious, right?
Absolutely.
That is so perfect. Thank you. The next question we have says, how do you involve the Lord in your writing?
Believe it or not, I actually do pray over just about everything. I mean, I pray about coaching, I pray about writing. And I think for me, it's every time I start a project, it's like asking the Lord, please help me make it something that'll be pleasing unto him. Cause I don't want to put something out. I mean, yes, I write about killing people, but only in the best possible way. Like, I don't kill good people, I promise. But I'm doing, I know I actually have a shirt that says, you know, like, careful or I may kill you, or, you know, dangerously close to being killed in my novel or something like that. But it's like trying to, you know, showing the force of good versus evil, and we all have to have opposition. And so seeing that positive in our lives, I think that's, you know, the main thing is just trying to keep that, you know, let the Lord know that, hey, I want to do what you want me to do. So let me, you know, trying to keep myself open to that inspiration.
Yeah, for sure.
I love that. That just reminded me of a song like, I'll go where you want me to go, dear Lord. Like, as we allow ourselves to do what God asks us to do, keep the way before us. We want to do it. So thank you. And to pull up our next question. Mary Holm says, I'm seeking to discover God, my God-given gifts and talents. How walking the light allowed you to discover yours?
You know, I think a lot of it is letting, we try to surround ourselves around, you know, with good people and people who are going to see the best in us. And like I said, you know, growing up, I thought I could do anything because largely my parents didn't tell me any different. So having people that are willing to say, you know, like, yeah, try it. I mean, where would I be now if somebody said, sorry, you know, authors really don't ever, you can't get a book published. Nobody does that. And that was why I was a closet writer. I was afraid of somebody telling me no. So sometimes just it's knowing what to keep in and what to share and finding those moments, but finding people you can trust that'll build you up, that really, we don't always see our own talents, but sometimes asking people you trust, what do you think my talents are? You'll be surprised at how many virtues you have that you maybe don't recognize.
That's perfect. I don't know if I have much to add to that. That's awesome. But to pull up our next question, says Traci, how were you able to juggle so many time-consuming achievements in your life and be able to succeed so well?
Okay, I have to say one of the big secrets of my success is a really awesome family. I mean, like, my husband even cooks dinner most nights. And honestly, my kids, they don't really eat cereal anymore because when I was get to the end of a book, I would just say, here's the cereal, there's the milk. If you're hungry, you know how to do it. So my kids are all pretty good cooks, actually. Like, they all know how to cook because I, you know. So I didn't always juggle well, but having a family that's patient with me when I'm not juggling well is pretty huge. But also, I do a lot of multitasking. Like I said, I actually write most, about 50 to 90% of my books while I'm on a treadmill or an exercise bike. Like, I have a little keyboard that I put on it. Because, you know, trying to find that balance, but also just you cut out some of the stuff that doesn't really bring you happiness. So like before COVID, when I was driving to the gym, I would put on my like a morning devotional and I would listen to that. So I'd be doing two things at once where I can still focus on what was important. So anyway, so I don't know. I'm also a very high energy. My husband calls me an energizer bunny. So I do have a high energy level, so that probably helps too.
Oh, I'm sure. That's awesome. And pull up our next question. I'm from Julia Corbridge. How did you learn more about the importance of opening up to others while you couldn't be open if you worked at the CIA?
So it was actually very interesting because I am generally a very open person, and like the first time I went on an airplane after joining the CIA, so I had to go to this, I had to go let them know that I was traveling out of the state and how I was going. And they said, all right, well, you can't tell anybody who you work for while you're on public transportation, because you put yourself at risk and others around you. And I'd never even thought about it. I was like, okay, that's, I understand that. I said, but what do I say? And I will tell you, so to get on this in the CIA, you have to take a polygraph. And the polygraph proved a fundamental point. I am a terrible liar, like awful. They framed it and said, this is what it looks like when somebody can't lie. And here's Tracy's. So I'm awful. So they had to train me how to tell the truth without telling the truth. So they were like, okay, you can't say that you work for the CIA. Let's think of something else. So I was going to graduate school at the time. They said, you can say you're a grad student. I was like, that you are. I said, I'm taking one class. I said, they don't know that. Everyone's going to assume they know what you mean. Or you can say you're a housewife. You're a housewife too. So they were teaching me these little tricks. And so they actually helped me to learn how to stay open and follow my personality without giving away any secrets. So it was really a weird situation, but they were great. They were like, yeah, Tracy, you just can't lie. We're going to teach you how to. And my kids, like, even my swimmers, they've kind of gotten on to me now, because they'll ask a question and I was like, and I will avoid it. I'll sidestep it in a way that they think I answered one question. I really didn't. I'm like, would I do that? Well, the answer was yes, but I'm not admitting to it. So there's little things that I would do that now my kids are a little too well trained. Interrogation skills, I really do need them to survive their teenage years. I only have two teenagers left. I'm hoping I make it.
Oh, man. Well, thank you for sharing that with us.
Thank you.
So funny. Yes, don't learn these skills. It's really not that good.
Yeah. Always tell the truth, right?
Yes. I know. That's good.
Yeah. Perfect. Well, to pull up our next question, it says, did you ever feel like in your time as a CIA agent, you had to choose between your work and God? How did you choose God?
You know, I was actually very fortunate that I never had that dilemma. One of the things that I constantly was doing was just praying that I would be in a, you know, be in a good situation and know what to do and things like that. But I never really had to the CIA, believe it or not, it's like it has a lot of regulations and they're very strict on what you can and can't do. And we're all there trying to be supportive of our country. So it really did not ever come up of, don't do this and, you know, you're going to have to. Now, granted, I will admit I may have bribed the computer guy with a cherry pie to get a new computer faster than I might have otherwise. But other than that, and that was not, there was nothing against the rules on that, just saying. So, generally I was working with good people. It was a very compatible job to what I was doing. The only reason I ended up leaving is because I truly wanted to raise my own kids. So,
I personally love that. Thank you. And to pull up our next question from Denise Rubel, what is your favorite scripture?
Oh my gosh, there's so many. There's just so many. I think probably like in Mosiah, there's just everything. Like, and the end of Ether, anything about charity is always a favorite. But I'm somebody, I read the scriptures as books. I'm not as good about like quoting a specific scripture, but the idea that charity never faileth, that whole theme, that is one of my favorites because it just is fabulous. So.
Perfect. And it's so pliable for our lives right now. Right. Every day. I love that. For our next question, it says, how do you continue to find inspiration for new novels when you feel like you've run out of ideas?
So I haven't hit the run out of ideas yet. I have about 40. Like, I have this problem. You know, it's kind of like when you have, you know, when somebody has kids and then the kids have kids and the kids have kids, that's what happens with my books. You know, it's like there's one character, but then they have a brother or sister and then they need a story and then their friend needs a story and it just keeps rippling through. So I haven't hit the, I'm running out of ideas. Like I have a storyboard right now that has, I think I'm out through 2024 and I'm not even close to being done. Like it's pretty bad. So I'll let you know in a few years if I ever get to that point, but they actually did this little roast on me when I had this one award from my publisher, and the managing editor at the time got up and she said, yeah, Tracy and I had this conversation one time, and my managing editor was trying to write a fiction novel, and she said, yeah, writing fiction's tough. I said, I know. How do you decide which idea to use? I'm like, I'm like at 27. How do I pick which one to write? And she just like, that conversation ended really quick because she was like trying to come up with the first idea. I'm like, oh, I'll give you one. So they were just, but yeah, fortunately or unfortunately, I don't run out. And then like, I actually just finished a project with Sean Bessie. We were writing back and forth and I was like, we're again different time zones, and so I'd go to bed and I'd wake up in the morning and there was a new scene, and so then she would wake up and then I had already written my new scene, and so it was like, this is like, feels like cheating, you know, because we're having this. So you know, that's been something that's been fun during COVID, is I did one also with Paige Edwards and A.L. Sowards with Sean Bessie. Originally it'll actually come out in October, but working with other authors has helped a lot because it is such an isolating it's a just me career. And so to do something with other people has been a lot of fun. But yeah, ideas, too many to count. I've got an actual box that says idea box on it. So I just throw ideas into it. So that's my solution. I will stir up the idea box, pull something out, and see what sticks.
I love it.
You're very blessed with lots of ideas.
Yeah.
We're excited to read all about them.
Pull up our next question from Jack Kelly. As you have your own battles within yourself, how do you pause and take a step back?
So I think a lot of times before COVID, one of my ways of just taking a step back and taking a little break was to travel. I do a research trip. And for me, research is usually going someplace I haven't been before that sounds interesting. And then a story will happen. I just don't know what. That's always helpful. And then also just, you know, confiding in friends and talking to people and things like that. I, you know, just rebounding what I'm struggling with, I think helps a lot, whether it's with my husband or one of my kids, because I've got adult kids now, or friends. That really helps me a lot. And walk in nature. I mean, go out in nature, and it's like, just, you can see the beauty the Lord's given us. And it's like, okay, it's not all bad. You know, everything can be contained. We can find peace. So
exactly. It's refreshing. Mm-hmm. There's still a lot of good in the world, right?
Absolutely.
Perfect. Well, we have loved hearing your responses, Tracy. Thank you so much. We have one last question for you for the night. And it says, how do you think we can grow our faith in order to become closer to God in making life-changing decisions?
I think probably the first thing is just recognizing the Lord in our lives, and also recognizing that sometimes there's not a right and a wrong decision. Like, we sometimes have to make the decision ourselves and ask the Lord, is this the right one, instead of saying, what should I do? And so doing our part and figuring things out the best we can before we take it to the Lord is, I think, half the battle. Because once we think what we know, I mean, if you go in and you're like, okay, what answer do I really want? You may already know deep down what the answer is. But when we're weighing it, we can get so conflicted. And also, you know, asking people you trust and things like that. Because again, sometimes if somebody's telling you what you don't want to hear, if you take it to the Lord and it's like, okay, that's making sense now, maybe they had a point. And sometimes they're saying you don't like it because they're pushing in a way that it's not the right thing. But however you do it, it's how are your emotions falling in? I think then you take to the Lord, you're going to find like, okay, this is the right answer. Whether you wanted the answer to be what it is or not, it's, you know, taking our time to make that choice first, I think is really important.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you, Tracy. That reminded me of, as a quote, like, think before you act, always like think about it first and then act. And sometimes we don't answer, and we just need to go to our Father in heaven to confirm. But as we talk to our Father in heaven, we will, that answer we confirm, we know what we need to go forward. Sometimes we just need to take that step into the dark.
Be willing to listen and to change, I think.
Yeah.
That was perfect. Thank you so much for your answers.
And thank you, everyone, for your questions. Before we end, we'd like to have a closing musical number by Paul Lewis and then a closing prayer by Mike Krockenberg. And then after that, Tracy will bring you back on. If you have any closing comments or things like to shift the audience, you're welcome to. And we'll go to that point from there.
Father in heaven, we are thankful for this time that we have to be gathered tonight to be inspired and uplifted and understand more about thy love and light for us. We are grateful for those who have prepared messages and music for us this evening. Please help us to feel thy spirit and feel the love of Jesus Christ through that preparation and through the music and messages that we hear. We're grateful for Sister Abramson and for her preparation, and look forward to hearing her message this evening. We ask a blessing to be upon us, that as we participate this evening, that we can find answers to the questions that we have and feel blessed from the light that comes from thy Son, Jesus Christ. We ask a blessing also to be upon all those who are suffering and affected by the pandemic and the other turmoil of this time. Please help thy light and thy love and thy peace shine forth and penetrate our hearts and the hearts of all thy children. We pray for these blessings and say this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much. That was a perfect way to end our night. And Sister Abramson, Traci Abramson, is there any other last thoughts you would like to add?
I think the one thing I keep thinking about is, I mentioned in the CIA that, backup plans are a big thing for us. I don't know if I mentioned that, but that is part of who I am, is everything has got a plan and then a backup and then a backup to the backup. But Lindsay Robbins quote, he says, repentance isn't God's backup plan in the event we might fail. His plan is knowing that we will, so that we're all going to have struggles and everything, but he's there for us no matter what. So I guess that's my last little thought, is just knowing that no matter what our struggles are, he knows it and he's ready for us.
That's perfect. Thank you so much. That was a great thought. I love that. I'm writing it down.
I think that's a great idea here tonight. Us, but also those in the audience and those who were able to attend and watch tonight, thank you so much. And if you have any questions or thoughts, please write them down and please message the page. And we will be there to answer them for you.
Yes, we'd love to hear any thoughts or any questions that you have about these devotionals. And we're excited to see you all next week, the next Walk in the Light devotional. So thank you so much, Ms. Davidson.
Thanks.
Good night.